And we remember we had started in Amos chapter 8 when he was talking about for them to behold that there was coming a famine in the land, and it's not a famine of food or water, but it was going to be about the Spirit and not having the Word of God. And so we got started on that, and we're going to continue on that. It's in quite a bit here of notes, but we're going to try to let you out earlier. Why? Because it's my birthday, and I'm ready to go home. I want to be able to sit back a little bit and enjoy the day with my wife. But we've had a wonderful day today, and thank you for all the people that said happy birthday and all like that. It's very much appreciated. Let's go ahead and have a word of prayer before we get started, okay? Father, thank you again for letting us come into your throne. God, I just stand in amazement at your power and your majesty. God, I just thank you allow us to be able to be a part of your Spirit world, to be able to feel your Holy Spirit within inside of us, to know that you give us guidance. Father, it's just amazing what all you do. We pray now as we get into this word, God, that you'll show us things that I know is happening here in America, but God, convict our hearts to where at least we will be good followers of you. We just thank you so much for what all you've done and what you're going to do. For we ask it in the precious name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So last Sunday we had talked about America being blessed with Bibles and religious freedom, which we are, you can't deny that. And then no matter where you go, you'll never see the freedom like that we have as far as the gospel of Jesus Christ. We talked about what preachers should be preaching. Unfortunately, we're failing in that. Most preachers now want to water down the gospel. They don't want to give the gospel like it really is. And I understand why. I'll be quite honest with you. When you preach the truth, people are going to get upset and you're going to hear all kinds of grumbling and complaining. And then people are going to get upset and they're going to leave because they don't want to hear it. And when they leave, there's no money coming in the church. Most of it boils down into the money situation. There's no doubt about that. I like I said before, I wish I could tell you everything's going to be great. I was telling someone the other day, and you may like it, but I'm going to warn you right now. My job is to let you know some things. And you may like this preacher. And he's very charismatic. His name's Ferguson. Anyone ever heard him? I don't watch him. I have people, friends of mine and family that loves Ferguson. But he makes statements like this. And it's subtle. You have to really watch what you're listening to. Because it's very subtle. This is what an insert that I've heard him say. He said, when God comes into you, that is God, the I am, that has come inside you. And he said, so therefore I can say, I am that I am. That's subtle. And of course, a whole crowd starts applauding. And it gives me chill bumps every time I say that. Folks, that's blasphemous. You are not the I am. If you're the I am, you can take care of all the world's problems. The I am through his Holy Spirit, in the form of the Holy Spirit, lives in you. He gives you power if you stay on his side, but you're not that I am. So preachers are doing that because it really makes you feel good. And of course, the old standby is Joel Osteen. If you had a bad week, just turn into his broadcast, and I promise you, you're going to feel like everything's A-okay and you're great. But buddy, that is not the job of the preachers today, and that's why America's falling into the place that she's at right now, because we have let all this stuff slide, and everyone wants to come hear that. The Bible said they'll come to hear that. They want their ears tickled. I'm not tickling ears tonight. Now, I love you, and I appreciate you, but if the Holy Spirit says something, we're going to say it, and if it hits home, you're either going to have to deal with it, or you're going to have to talk to God. But one thing about it, when we come into the house of God, it's his house, it's his rules, and we have to abide by that. So we talked about that a little and how they failed to preach the gospel. And we also talked about the results, which would bring spiritual hunger and thirst. We got started into 2 Timothy, and I really wasn't going to plant my roots there, but I decided to after we got started because of the fact there's so much in there that represents the way that America is now. I can't just go over these verses and let it slide. And we're going to go over this again, and I want you to, we stopped almost right at the beginning, but I want us to see how far we've slipped. I remember a time when I was sitting with my mother and we was at a restaurant. Two gentlemen were behind me, I say that loosely, and they were cursing. And Daddy sat there very quietly for a while. And finally, Daddy turned around to both of them and they said, he said, listen to me. He said, my wife and my boy is sitting right here. And he said, you've got two options. You can either stop that cussing in front of them, or I'm going to bust your mouth and make you stop. I still remember a time when people respected the house of God. They respected Christians. They respected the church. They respected women and children. We're not there anymore. Matter of fact, when you see what's going on with our children today, it's astounding to see how much we disrespect. But I remember that time, and Daddy was living in that particular time, and he would have done what he said he was going to do. He was at one time he was a professional, a Golden Glove boxer, so he could have done what he said. He wouldn't just run his mouth. But I appreciated that about my daddy. That made me feel good to know that I had a father that would stand up against this world and say, not in front of my boy. Not in front of my boy. And now the sad thing about it is most Christians today don't even have a stranger doing it. They've got their TV on and it's playing things that they don't need to be listening to. And that child is sitting right there, and all the while you go to church and you say, I'm a Christian, bless God. Ooh, we get quiet now. I told you I'm surprised y'all came back. But it's the truth. We're allowing it in our homes. And it shouldn't be that way. Man, when we're at home, in front of our children, in front of our family, we should live a life that's the same as when we're in the church, to where even our family will recognize that you're a Christian. It's not a Christian here on Sunday and on Wednesday and then home do whatever you want. That's not the way life goes. You're a Christian 24/7. And that's where we need to be. But let's go ahead and go back into 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. It says, this is the result of not preaching the word, not turning to God, not listening to him. It says, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. Now, we all know that we're there now. It's going to get worse. This is just the beginning of sorrow, the Bible talks about. Just the beginning. So if you think it's tough now, just hang around. Just hang around. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. I think everyone can relate to people like this. While we're reading these things, just think about some of your friends. Think about some of your family. Oh, buddy, we're living in a day where you love yourself. And I know this is something that's been browbeaten to death here lately. But one good example of that, about loving yourself, is these women sitting there saying, my body, my rights. That means I love me more than I do the unborn child that's within me. I love me than to have to face the decisions of something that I did that was wrong to begin with. That's coming from a society that just loves themselves. And that's where we're at, covetousness. Everybody wants something that someone else has got. You know, that's a good thing about living out in the country in a modular home. Ain't nobody sitting there saying, whoa, I really want that one. But thank God we've got a place. And I love my place. I love that house. But we don't have to worry about that. But I tell you, there are people that go down the road, head to church, and say, I wish God would give me that. You know what that means? There's one house that we go by going to Walmart. I love the house. Beautiful. Spanish made. I love Spanish built houses. It's a $2.5 million home. Got a pool in the back. I mean, it's got exercise. I'm like, I would use it. But it had an exercise room. Everything. Had a circle driveway. 4-car garage. I mean, anything you can think of. And I told my wife, even if they gave it to me, I wouldn't want it. Really? Yeah, I couldn't afford the tax on it. I wouldn't be able to afford the utilities on it. And for what? Just so that I say, I have to live over there? I don't care. I'm just grateful because you know what? That old modular home that we got, that's not my home. You want to come to my house, you're going to have to wait a little while. And if you're a Christian, I'll let you come up to my place and then see what I got. Paid debt free. Don't have to worry about the utility bills or nothing else. But people are covetous now. They want everything that somebody else got. Boasters. You know anyone that brags about herself? That's heavy in the church. Unfortunately, that is heavy. And look what I do. Look what I accomplish. Look at me. and proud. About the same thing. Blasphemers. We just had got through talking about a preacher that blasphemes against God. We are so loose with this tongue right here. Remember, there is a commandment that said, thou shalt not take the Lord's name in vain. And I hate to say it, but Christians do that. All you got to do is smack your finger, and words come out. Be very careful what words are coming out of your mouth there in that time. And that's unfortunate we have that in the church. Disobedient to parents. Every one of y'all disobedient to your parents. I can tell you. I can tell by looking your face and the way you act. Every one of you disobedient to your parents, aren't you? Most likely we have kids, though, right? We're now the parents. Unthankful. Unthankful. Unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers. Anyone ever seen that in the church? Oh, there's a laugh there. Evidently seen that a good bit, haven't you? Tell flat out lies on people. Incontinent, furious, despisers of those that are good. You know this whole thing that they kept calling us names? They despise good. And I'm not trying to get political, and I know we're dealing with that subject, and it seems like it's a beaten drum. But, buddy, that shows how far our world's gone. They can't stand to be around good people. And yet the very ones that's saying that are quick to say, I'm a Baptist. I'm a Catholic. But, buddy, if your life doesn't stand behind it, I don't care what your denomination is. If you've not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, if you don't stand for good, you're lost. Simple as that. Traitors, high-headed, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, he says, turn away. Like I said, we have a lot of this that's in the church today. Having a form of godliness. You know what a form of godliness is? That's when you get up and you put your Sunday best on. You come to church and you sit on that bench and say, bless me if you can, preacher. That's a form of godliness. Or when you sit there and brag about your relationship with Jesus Christ, but your life doesn't prove it. You're not doing at home what you're supposed to do. You're praying and stuff like that. Now, don't look like I'm chewing y'all out. We're talking about people out in the airways and everything else. Yeah. But I've got to present things that's happening today. We can't let stuff like this on. It says, for of this sort are they which crept into houses, led captive silly women, laden with sins, led away by divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of truth. Now, I can tell you this, and I think most of you in here can remember this time, and we'll try to stick main with these notes. I remember a time when God was really good to America. How do I remember when America was really the great? You say it's still the great. Well, it's still good. But we're heading on a path that's not great. But, buddy, I remember the time when I went to another country. I strutted my chest a little bit because I was an American. People respected America. People was wanting to come to America. We were one of the most wealthiest, if not the wealthiest, nation in the world. We're not that anymore. A matter of fact, we were so wealthy that even though we were in debt, we had a perfect credit score. And now it's dropped. Listen, they want to take over America, all they have to do is call in the debt. We owe so much money, we can't even pay the principal on it. You know why it gets that way? Because the very things we just read about. Pride, covetousness, wanting things when we can't afford it. That's what all this is about. But I remember that. And I remember a time when America respected by her power. I remember a time when presidents, all they had to do is tell another leader of a country, back off or we're coming. And buddy, they'd back off. We're not that way anymore. We got that little nut over there in North Korea who shakes his fist at us and says, I'm going to blow you up. No country would have done that. And you may disagree with me, but there is strength in power. You say, how come you say that? Well, how many has ever heard the whole old statement, if the bigger they are, the harder they fall? How many has ever dug into somebody that was bigger? Did you find out they were a little bit tough to get down? They don't tell you the other half of that. Yeah, they fall harder. Mike said he ran. They fall harder, but getting them down is the problem. And I'm telling you what, when you've got a nation that is strong militarily, us little old nations don't want to pick on you. But we've gotten to ourselves where we don't feel like that's important. Matter of fact, we talked about it here a good while back, about how our military is now. It's training the guys. We're not ready for battle. Well, if it's a computer battle and all like that, we might be able to handle it. But if we ever get foot to foot, we're in trouble. Because them, I call them pansies. Them pansies being trained today, there's no way they're going to be able to fight a battle. They're wrong. They've not been trained. People all around the world wanted to come to America. Everybody wanted to be an American. Even dictators would be envious of us. They wanted what we got, but they didn't want to let go of that power. And that's the way America used to be. We're one of the last places in the world that's still allowing the freedom to preach the word of God and to worship God the way we choose. Every day, and I feel like this, every day we need to thank God that we've got that. Every day. Because it can go in a heartbeat. Like you said, it could have went in a boat. It could have went. I see the tide turning. People are coming against the church at an alarming rate. People don't want to hear the truth of God's word. They want to live their lives the way they want to, regardless of the warnings of what God will do to them. We just got through going through the book of Revelation. We've seen that in Revelation 2, didn't we? God was in problems. He had sent problems. He had sent problems. But they just determined to get what they want. And that's where we're getting at. How many times does God have to come and whip us at this nation before we finally wake up and say, okay, God, I get the picture. We're going to surrender now. Christianity in the United States has been on decline for at least the past 20 years at an alarming rate. Matter of fact, it wasn't that long ago that over half of America, well over half of America, was Christian. Now they're saying that they don't even believe it's half of America. And from what we hear on the way that things were spoken during this election, I've got to agree with that. And unfortunately, we still have a lot of people who claim they've come to church and they do things like that, but they don't have the spirit within them. Missionaries from other countries are now telling us that we don't want you to come to this country. Please go back to America, because America's in worse shape than we are. Because at least there they're hearing the word of God and they're repenting and they're getting saved. But here they hear the word of God every single Sunday and no one moves to this altar. No one moves. God is being pushed out of our school, our justice system, and sadly even out of most families. We have become a nation that is divided. You remember the Bible says something about that. We think America never falls. But the Bible says a house that's divided against itself will fall. And we continue to be divided, this nation will fall. As far as justice, we become a nation where right is called wrong and wrong is called right. We have lowered our standards to accommodate everything. We give a woman the right to kill her unborn baby, but God forbid that you kill a baby sea turtle. That's sad. Anyone ever been to Florida when the sea turtles are out? They put that little string around that nest. And you best not cross that string. Because you'll go to jail quick. And if you do any one of them, you're going to jail for a long time. But it's nothing for a mother to go right down the street and slaughter a baby. You say, it ain't really a baby. Then why? Tell me why it's not a living baby. Why, when they go in there with that machinery, that baby runs from it? You know that happens, right? That baby knows that they're trying to kill it, and it tries its best to defend itself. And we're in a nation that says, I would rather do that than have to pay the consequence of raising this child or giving it away. My goodness gracious, all they got to do is carry it for 9 months. Somebody be glad to take it. You say, I can't find no one. My wife might kill me for this. If you can't find no one, I know we're on up in age. I'll take it. I'll love it. I'll let it know that there's a God that loves it. Yeah. I'll let it know that there's an answer that if he'll turn to it, his life will be better. I'll teach him a way to where he will find out that even when the world is going down, he can trust in the God that will carry you up. It's just an excuse to be able to kill him. Every believer is protected except Christianity. Don't say nothing against the Muslims. Don't say anything about Buddhists or anyone else. But it's okay to get on there and make statements and make fun of Christianity. That's the thing they do. Comedians make fun of Christianity all the time. For goodness sakes, the lady running for the White House says we're in the wrong area if you come in mentioning Jesus Christ. No, my goodness, lady, you're in the wrong country if I can't mention Jesus Christ, because that's what this nation is founded on. You're in the wrong place. You're the one that needs to go. But we fell to such a point that where they're allowed to say that. Christianity is labeled as hate speech. Intolerant because we stand for what God says, although our nation was based on his word. Don't get me wrong. And I say this quite often, but don't get me wrong. When I preach on things that are hard, it's not hate speech. On the contrary, it's out of love. Because I've read the book, and I know what the book says if you continue down that path. And I would be a hater if I would sit there and smile at you and say, oh, it's okay, keep going, knowing where your destiny is going to be. So it's out of love that I sit there and rebuke people. It's out of love. And tolerant, like I said, I'm tolerant to a certain point. I'm tolerant for you to enter these doors. I'm tolerant for you to hear the word of God. But the moment that you start crossing the line and making a scene in the church, or the moment you think you're going to hold a position when you're out of God's will, that ain't happening. I'm not tolerant there. And that's where we have to stand in the church, whether it hurts or don't. The rights of the people have overcome the law of God. There's only one absolute truth. We'll be talking about that, I think, Wednesday night, right? And the lawgiver. And that's God and his word. Nothing else compares to that. When we don't go by it, we'll have injustice, law system, and chaos. That's where we're at now. Liberty for all has been mistaken for giving deadbeats and illegal money and support while taking away from the hardworking Americans, our senior citizens, our veterans, to give our hard-earned money to support them. How many's got plenty of money you can just give away like that? How many right now wants to take on about 5 illegals and buy them a nice house? Let me ask this question then. How many could use some extra money? How many Social Security is taking you through life real good? We've got things stood backwards, folks. Them veterans that come and stood down here, we owe our lives to these people. There is no reason at any time a veteran should have to be in need. They fought for this country. Amen. And yet a deadbeat can break into this country and they get more than any of us has ever seen in our lives. They stay in buildings that are better than any home that we live in. They get fed better than any meal that we have. Something's wrong with this nation when we allow that to happen. Our politicians no longer work for the people, but have plainly shown us they don't care what the majority of people want. You can have all of this. You can have everything that America talks about. But if you don't have God, that's where these scriptures are talking about. You become hungry, and you become thirsty. And it's not for whatever you think. And you say, well, that's depression. I wish now I had never came. I mean, my goodness, all you've done is just dog the country, you dog Christians, you dog this, you dog... No, I just showed you some truth. But can I tell you, there's also hope. There is a remedy. And the reason that the Bible puts in stuff like this, it shows that we can turn around and say, what do we do from this point? Well, let's go into that. When you look over there at what Amos was talking about, you'll find two main messages that he was telling the people. And this is what we need to really be telling others and be looking at it ourselves. The first one is to seek me and live. You want to change everything? You have to seek God. You turn to him and he will turn the tides. Isaiah chapter 55 verse 6. Seek ye the Lord, and I love this part, while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. What's he talking about, preacher? He's talking about one single thing. He's saying if you don't seek me and you don't come after me, there's going to come a time, the Bible says, where I will laugh when you call upon my name. He'll laugh at our troubles. We don't want America to get into that point, do we? Then the second thing he was trying to tell them is seek good and not evil. Romans chapter 12, verse 9. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. James 4:4, ye adulterers and adulteresses. Know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore would be a friend of the world is enemy of God. See, there is a difference. We do supposed to separate ourselves. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. What God's saying here is what I just said. As a church, and I'm not talking about this church in general, I'm talking about the church. As a church, we better return to God. We better seek what we need. And then we need to offer the water. This is where the remedy comes in. When people don't know where to go, what to do, don't know how to handle life, this is where the church steps in. Because how many knows that he said he'd provide us a water, a living water, that would flow outward? What's the reason for outward? So that people can drink of the living water. Jesus went to the woman at the well. He said, look, you got rid of your earthly water, but I can give you water where you won't thirst anymore. So this world right now, what we're seeing in our elections, although it makes you mad, although it makes us upset, it's actually our opportunity to let these people know that you are hungry and thirsty for something that you can't find. But I got the solution, and I got a lot of it. And we offer them that water because Jesus Christ can do that for them. Jesus said in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him that heareth say, come, and let him that is athirst come, and whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. Jesus told the woman that he'd give her that water, and she would never thirst again, and that happened to her. You remember the whole story? Once she got a taste of that water, she went and told everybody what God had brought to her through Jesus Christ. How many has had the Lord Jesus Christ to bring you a fresh drink of water? When you was in a thirsty world, didn't have no answers, needed something and couldn't find it, and then he come and gave you life-giving water. If he gave it to you, then we're supposed to give it back out. We're supposed to go to them places that Jesus went to where no one else wanted to go to and talk to them people and say, look, I've got the answer for you. I've got what you need. And you say, well, that never happens for me. I'm afraid to do that. If you will pray for God to send someone in your life, God will send someone into your life for you to minister to. You say, well, I can't spare up a conversation and ask God to have them to open up the door. Listen very carefully. Ed Lowe, when he would go witness to someone, what I loved about him is he didn't go around there thumping his Bible and all that other stuff. He would sit there and he'd get talking about creation. Like for instance, if there was a watermelon man, he would begin to talk about creation. And he'd say, do you know what? He said, you say you're in the watermelon business? Yeah. He'd say, did you know that every watermelon has even stripes on it? How many knew that? Most people don't. Most people, the ones that even grow the watermelon, don't know that. And he'd say, really? He'd say, yeah. And he'd start telling them more about his business and asking more about his business. And then he slips it in. Only God could do that. Or if someone asked him, what makes you so happy? Listen, if they ask you, it's an open door, my friend. And if they get mad, you say, wait. I'm just trying to answer your question. But we need to share what God has done for us. John chapter 4, verse 13. And we're going back over to that woman. Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh this water shall never thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. We got down here that there will be a time when there'll be no more preaching the truth. Listen, there's coming a time. I won't be up here. There's going to be no more spiritual counselors. You want to know what's going on, and there'll be no preachers to say, well, this is what's happening. It's coming upon. There'll be no faithful reprover. You say, I don't like being reproved. Trust me, it's good for you. But there'll come a time when no one's going to get up and reprove you anymore. No one to point the way of salvation to tell that truth or assure them that the mercy of God, if they repent, return to Him. There's coming a day when no one will be there to guide or comfort them in their distress. You talk about a sad time. When that time gets here, they'll have the written word, but there'll be no power behind it, because there'll be no one there to explain it, no one to show them how to apply it in their life. They'd have water, but nothing to draw with. It's available right there, but they won't want it. The Lord will be precious and scarce. Not only that, but there'll be no vision. What does the Bible say about that? Without a vision, the people perish. We're going to have a vision. So what are we to do? Well, people, we need to turn back to God, number one. We need to follow the guidance that He gives, and we need to warn our family and friends. That's what we need to be doing. We must let people know that there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shine. Old statement, but it's so true. There's a heaven to gain and hell to shine. The only thing I can suggest is because of the fact that we see America the way she is, and because of the fact that the rivers of life flow within each and every one of us, we need to give somebody a drink of water, don't we? We need to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's easy to receive it here in the church, but we need to make sure we're getting it out that door. And one good thing about it, and that's one of the reasons I'm glad we've got an avenue now where we're speaking to the possibility of 500,000 people. It's because He said His word won't come back void. So every time that message goes out through the airways, every time it goes through Facebook, we don't know who's listening. And if a life is changed, we get a chalk mark for the church. And you get a chalk mark for yourself because you become a son. Don't get discarded, folks. Everything that we do is to reach the lost at any